Our dear viewers and listeners,
we greet you
all in the wonderful and precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
This is
the day the Lord has
made.
And we shall rejoice
and
be glad in it. Welcome to today's Bible study.
And let's
open up today's session with a word of prayer.
Father, we love you.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you for your grace.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you for your presence.
Yes, Lord.
Open our eyes that we might see the things that you have prepared for us to see.
Yes, Lord.
Spirit of the living God, lead us where you want us to go. Guide us where you want us to go.
Yes, Lord.
Speak through us.
Yes, Lord.
Magnify your word above every opinion of men.
Yes, Lord.
Let the glory of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ be revealed, that people may come to you, Heavenly Father. For you say in your word that if you be lifted up, you draw men to you. Even today, have your way in us, that through us you might draw men to the kingdom of God. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen.
When we began last week,
we twatandika week edi,
we have been unveiling the adversary. And we now go a step deeper as we continue to look through the book of Revelation to gain an understanding on how the demonic forces of darkness operate. And today, a picture is very open for us to continue to gain insight on how the machinations of the enemy work behind the scenes. Today, if you ask somebody of what the devil looks like, you will be astounded by the responses you get. For many people, when they talk about the devil, others have a picture of a snake going around. Some think it is a dark figure, ugly, with wings that is dialoguing with Jesus in the wilderness. You see, when you don't have the correct picture of who your adversary is, then you are exactly where he wants you to be. You see, the mindset the devil has created in the hearts of men has been twofold. In some instances, he has painted the picture that he does not exist. And as a result, whatever he does, men appropriate it to something else. Men appropriate his actions to somebody else and not the devil himself. So if he is in that place, he's okay. Then others give so much attention to the devil that even where the responsibility is called for, they still delegate that responsibility and place it in the hands of the enemy. Both schools of thought are poisonous and will not advance us to where God wants us to be. They both leave us in the place where the devil wants us to be. So what is that place, you may ask? It is darkness. Because in darkness, that is where he thrives.
Kubanga Satani ye akolera nnyo mu kizikiza.
He is the prince of darkness.
Ye mulangira w'ekizikiza.
He's the one who holds the power over everything that is represented by darkness.
Ye alina amaanyi ku buli kintu ekikiikirira ekizikiza.
Because in darkness, ignorance thrives.
Kubanga mu kizikiza osanga obutamanya.
In darkness, the demonic holds sway.
Awali ekizikiza ne daimon zifugirawo.
In darkness, the power of light is not evident.
Mu kizikiza kizibu nnyo okulaba ekitangaala.
In darkness,
era mu kizikiza,
the light of Christ,
ekitangaala kya Kristo,
is absent.
Tekirabika.
And where the light of Christ is absent,
era w'otalaba kitangaala kya Kristo,
then there is no victory for humanity.
Awo tosangawo buwanguzi eri abaana b'abantu.
So in today's text,
kati mu byawandiikibwa by'olwaleero,
I want us to see someone
nina omuntu gwenjagala twetege
arising
ngagolokoka
out of an obscure situation
ngava ava eri gyotalaba.
And we will take the reading
era tugenda kusoma okuva
from the book of Revelation chapter 13
ekitabo ky'okubikulibwa 13
from verse 1
okutandika mu lunyiriri olusooka
to verse 10
paka mu lwa 10.
The Bible says,
Bible yegamba,
the dragon stood on the shore of the sea,
ogusota ne guimirira ku musenyu gwennyanja,
and I saw a beast coming up out of the sea.
Nenda bensolo ngeva mu nyanja.
It had 10 horns,
yalina mayembe 10,
and 7 heads,
n'emitwe musanvu,
with 10 crowns on its horns,
n'engule 10 ku mayembe gago,
on each head a blasphemous name,
nga buli ku mutwe kuliko erinnya ery'obuvvoozi.
The beast I saw resembled a leopard,
ensolo gye nalabanga yali ng'engo,
but had feet like those of a bear,
ng'erina ebigere ng'ebyeddubu,
and a mouth like that of a lion,
n'akamwanga ak'empologoma.
The dragon gave the beast his power,
ogusota gwawa amaanyi gaayo eri ekisolo,
and his throne,
n'obwakabaka bwayo,
and great authority,
n'obuyinza obungi.
One of the heads of the beast seemed to have had a fatal wound,
omutwe ogumu gwalina ekiwundu,
but the fatal wound had been healed,
naye ekiwundu ne kiwona.
The whole world was filled with wonder,
ensi yonna ne yeewuunya,
and followed the beast,
n'egoberera ensolo.
People worshipped the dragon,
abantu ne basinza ogusota,
because he had given great authority to the beast,
kubanga gwawa obuyinza bwayo eri ensolo.
And they also worshipped the beast,
ne basinza n'ensolo,
and asked,
ne babuuza,
who is like the beast,
ani afaanana ng'ensolo,
who can wage war against it,
anaasobola ayinza okulwana nayo.
The beast was given a mouth to utter proud words and blasphemies,
neweebwa akamwa okwogera ebikulu n'obuvvoozi,
and to exercise its authority for 42 months,
n'okozesa obuyinza bwayo olw'emyezi 42.
It opened its mouth to blaspheme God,
neyasamya akamwa kaayo okuvvoola Katonda,
and to slander his name,
n'okuvvoola
and his dwelling place,
neweema ye,
and those who dwell in heaven,
n'abatuula mu ggulu.
It was given power to wage war against God's holy people,
neweebwa obuyinza okulwana n'abatukuvu ba Katonda,
and to conquer them,
n'okubawangula.
It was given authority over every tribe,
neweebwa obuyinza buli ku kika,
people,
abantu,
language and nation,
ennimi n'amawanga.
All the inhabitants of the earth,
era bonna abatuula ku nsi,
will worship the beast,
balisinza ensolo.
All those whose names are not written in the Lamb's book of life,
n'abo abatawandiikibwa mu kitabo ky'omwana gw'endiga.
The Lamb who was slain from the creation of the world,
eyattibwa kuva kutondebwa kw'ensi.
Whoever has ears,
oye nayina amatu,
let him hear,
awulire.
If anyone is to go into captivity,
omuntu yenna waba agenda mu bwaŋŋanguse,
into captivity they will go,
asigaleyo mu bwaŋŋanguse.
If anyone is to be killed,
omuntu yenna waba nga wakuttibwa,
with the sword,
n'ekitala,
with the sword they will be killed,
kimugwanira okuttibwa n'ekitala.
This calls for patient endurance and faithfulness on part of God's people,
awo wewali okugumikiriza n'obwesimbu n'obwesige obw'abatukuvu ba Katonda.
In this text,
mu byawandiikibwa bino,
we have the most descriptive,
tulina okunnyonnyolwa okwa waggulu nnyo,
account of who the beast is,
ku ani ekisolo kino,
And here John opens the account for us.
Wano Yokana atandika ebyawandiikibwa.
In an amazing way.
Mu ngeri eyewuunya
nnyo. We are picking up from the end of chapter 12.
Tutandikira ku nkomerero y'essula ya 12.
And in chapter 12 we saw.
Era mu 12 twalaba.
That the dragon.
Ntogusota.
Whom we identified as the devil.
Gwe twategeera nti ye Satani.
Had been cast down.
Ngasulidwa wansi.
We discovered that he and his cohorts.
Twazula nti wamu ne bamalaika baabwe.
Had lost several wars.
Ba entalo nyingi ba zabalema.
I told you the first one they lost.
Nabagamba entalo bebasoko
kuwazwa. With the Lord Jesus himself.
Oro ngabalwana ne mukama wafe Yesu.
In his life, death and resurrection.
Mubulamu bwe mukufa ne mukuzukira okuva mu bafu.
He overcame the devil.
Yawangula daimoni.
And all his cohorts.
Wamune emizimu gye.
Then we see another victory over the devil.
Netulaba obuwanguzi obulala.
This one executed with the war in the heavenlies.
Obo bwaliwo mu lutalo olwali mu ggulu.
From verse 7 to 9 of chapter 12.
Okuva ku lunyiriri olw'omusanvu paka olwa 12.
We learn that the devil.
Twayiga nti Sitani.
And his angels waged war against Michael and his angels.
Neba malaika be, neba ruana wamu ne Mikaeli, neba malaika be.
And he lost that battle.
No lutalo no.
And as a result, he was thrown on the earth.
Erebi avamu na suri wakunsi.
That's 2-0.
Awo biri 0.
Then we get to see another battle.
Netulabo lutalo olulala.
That he loses.
Orona ro neba muwangula.
And the Bible says he was overcome.
Bible yetugamba nti bamuwangula.
And the ones that overcame him.
Ataba bamuwangula.
Are the Lord's witnesses.
Beba abajulira bamukama waffe.
And they overcame him.
Era bamuwangula.
Two, three aspects.
Mungeri satu.
Number one.
Isoka.
The blood of the Lamb.
Omusayi gw'omwana gw'endiga.
And the Lamb is the Lord Jesus Christ.
Omwana gw'endiga ye Yesu
Kristo. The one whom John saw.
Oyo Yokana gwe yalaba.
And he pointed humanity to him.
Nasonga abantu gyali.
And said, behold the Lamb of God.
Nabagamba mulabe omwana gw'endiga.
Who takes away the sins of the world.
Ajjawo ebibi by'ensi yonna.
Pointing to the Lord Jesus Christ.
Nasonga mukama waffe Yesu Kristo.
There was now approaching him.
Ngajajali.
When he died.
We are far.
We that believe in him.
Katifena bamukiririza.
Through his blood.
Oromsayi.
We have victory.
Tuino obuwanguzi.
Over the devil.
Okusitani.
Not only that.
Secho choka.
We have a second weapon.
Tuline chokulani
secho. The Bible says the word of their testimony.
Bible yachite ekigambo ky'obujulizi bwaffe.
When we get saved.
We tulokoka.
We bear a testimony.
Tuino obujulizi.
A testimony that is so profound.
Obujulizi bujudda amaanyi.
That cannot be resisted.
Nga tosobola kubulwanisa.
By any doubters.
Eri bonna ababuusabuusa.
People can have different thoughts.
Abantu bayinza okwawukana mu
mirowoozo. But you cannot dispute a changed life.
Ne tusobola kuwakanya obulamu nga bukyusiddwa.
You cannot dispute.
Tosobola kuwakanya.
A life that was going to the doldrums.
Obulamu obwali bugenda mu kuzikirira.
But has now been turned round.
Ne bukyusibwa.
By the grace and the power of God. That word of testimony has so many witnesses all over the world. Men and women who testify that this is who I am. And I am different from the one who was. I have been crucified with Christ. Yet I live. Not I. But the grace of God. That lives in me. Every true believer in Jesus Christ. Bears a testimony. Of the faithfulness of God. Of the love of God. Of the mercies of God. And of the grace of God operating in their
lives.
And through this testimony, men and women are changed for all eternity. And the third weapon the Bible tells us that they used to overcome him is the supreme love of Jesus Christ. Whereby they did not even fear to die. You see, when you are totally surrendered to Christ,
obanga we waddeyo wenne eri Yesu Kristo.
You don't mind.
Gwetofayo.
Your life is hid in Christ in God.
Kubanga obulamu bwakwekebwa mu Kristo
mu Katonda. And your thoughts are placed above. And not on what is on the earth. It is not about what you have or what you don't have. It is about witnessing for Jesus. And Him alone. And such love. Why such love? Because He first loved. That while we were yet sinners, the Bible gives us this account. Christ died for us.
Christo yatufirira.
Greater love has no man than to lay his life for his friends. Can you imagine?
Jagala we wunye.
Why we were considering him an enemy?
Fenga tuloza yali mulabe wafe.
He
yeah.
Was referring to us
yalia tujita
as friends.
Mikwano je.
Last week, I had this opportunity to attend a funeral service
okubera kulumbe
of a dear departed one.
Elio mwagano yali ageze.
And while the hymns were being sung, I turned to somebody I was with next. And we began to recall this particular song that was being sung. And I remember one vigil I was attending. And we were sponsoring one drunkard to insult the born again. To insult those that believed in Jesus Christ. And we kept the booze flowing. Because we wanted them to hurl as many insults to them. Why? Because we looked at Jesus with hatred. But His love for us was not changed. And it is that love that drew us to Him. And that's why today I stand before you testifying of the love of God. Because even when I was His enemy, His response to me was love. And it is that love that drew me to the cross. It is that love that dragged me out of my hopeless situation, washed my sins, and drew me to the kingdom of God. Today, we sing of that love. We proclaim of that love. We speak of that love. A love that you and I, a love that I want you who has not received Jesus Christ
in their
life to receive and experience. We see in the scriptures that the devil, having now lost the war, having lost the battle in the heavenlies, now he comes to a place where the woman who is Israel is now out of his reach. He now sets up with an agenda to war against his offspring, to deceive the world, and to blaspheme God. And it is this that opens us the account in chapter 13, where John says, I saw the dragon standing on this seashore. He sees this picture of the devil Satan himself standing with his eyes focusing on the sea. And he's looking for two things that I want you to see. One is thinking about the best way to persecute the offspring of the woman, who is Israel.
lyeggwanga lya Israeli.
And secondly,
n'ekyokubiri,
is looking for the opportunity
anoonya omwagaalo
to arise
ogolokoka
and get control power
atwala obufuzi
to the extent that he gets to be worshipped. And it is against this background that John then presents to us symbols of what he sees happen next. The Bible tells us that as John is standing, what he notices is that out of the sea comes
beast.
Now this language has a lot of symbolism, and we need to understand exactly what is happening. I want us to first look at the sons of the sea. Now the sons of the sea portrays many people. It portrays many nations, a number of whom are this as the sons of the sea. Now, seeing the devil or the dragon standing on the sons of the sea, it is portraying him having authority and rulership over many peoples, over peoples of every tribe and tongue. Now, for you to understand what is happening here, he has influence over people, and he is using so many mechanisms to be able to have that authority. He will use human institutions. He's going to use secular powers and systems that operate within the day. He will also use wicked rulers
whom
he will place in charge over these systems to control humanity with the objective of driving humanity to worship him. I want to take you back to chapter 6 of the book of Revelation, because that is where it all begins. We see him as the white horse, the one coming on the white horse, and his tactics are tactics of peace. He comes with such smooth tongue, with a charismatic personality. He comes to play the power politics of the day. He pretends he understands the situation of humanity. With the persuasive language, he confesses them that he is the solution to the times. And we see that in Revelation chapter 6 from verse 1 to verse
2.
Daniel chapter
8
verses 23 tells us about the same. And as a result of his persuasion, nations now come together under his authority, and he then arises to take charge. But in parallel, when we read Daniel chapter 9 and verse 27, we see that he not only takes charge but also presents himself as the solution to Israel's dilemma. So the nation of Israel buys into him, believes that he is the solution. And the nations then confederate. He becomes the king. He becomes the head of all these states that come together. And the prominent of them will then produce the 10 nations that will come together with him as the head. I want you to see something. He is coming out of the sea. And the sea, when we go back to Daniel, he points us to the fact that the sea is actually people. It represents kingdoms. But who right now have decided to abandon the Prince of Peace and are now being tossed back and forth like the waves of the sea are. So now we see the beast coming out of this situation of chaos. Now you may ask, who is the beast? You got it. He is the Antichrist. He is the one who comes with the agenda. And the agenda is to make sure that he puts in place a kingdom here on earth that will prevent the kingdom of Christ from being made manifest. But now we see who gives the power to who. For the Bible tells us that the dragon is standing on the sands. And as the beast arises out of the water, the dragon gives the beast power, which is dunamis. He gives him his kingdom. And he also gives him authority, the right to rule. And so the beast, who is the Antichrist, now arises, anointed by the devil. He is now sent forward to fulfill the devil's agenda. I want you to see something here. They are trying to mimic something here. Throughout Jesus' ministry, in the Gospel according to John, he says, whatsoever the Father has, he has given me, and he has now sent me. Look here. I want you to see the description of the beast that arises out of the water. Look at what the Bible tells us. It says, concerning this beast, that it had 10 horns, 7 heads, with 10 crowns on its horns, and each having a blasphemous name. I want you to see something. You're going to see the crowns. You're going to see the horns. And you're going to see the 7 heads. If you open your Bible and went a chapter back, where we now see the dragon being made manifest, chapter 3, the Bible says, then another sign appeared in heaven, an enormous red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns. Look at what is happening here. The beast that comes out has 7 heads. It has 7 horns. And then we see 10 crowns. Similar to the one who gives him the authority
and
sends him forth. So what is the point I'm trying to drive home? That now the beast arises, and when you read through the scriptures, never in history, and there will never be a human being that will be as anointed by the devil as the beast or the Antichrist. He bears every quality. He bears the very nature of everything the devil stands for. His mission is the devil's mission. His agenda is to fulfill the agenda of him who sent him. In the later chapters, we shall see the third person or the third character who, together with the beast and the dragon, form the unholy trinity. Which mimics the Holy Trinity. So the objective,
brethren,
is to ensure that a kingdom is set on earth. And this kingdom has one objective: to ensure that Christ's kingdom will never be established on the earth.
Okulwana okulemesa obwakabaka bwa Kristo kusimbibwa ku nsi.
Now I want you to see something concerning the crowns
naddala ku ngule zino
on the head.
Ezitudde ku mitwe.
The Bible says,
Bible yetugamba,
that each one had a blasphemous name.
Buli omu yaina erinnya ery'okuvvoola.
Now I told you before that when the devil set out his agenda, he wants to achieve it through three prongs. The first one is to declare war against the saints. The second one is to deceive the world. So if he can't put you into direct conflict, then he will use deception. And the third one is the one almost goes beneath what we are able to perceive. He uses blasphemy. Now, the term blasphemy is many times confused. Because it is not obvious. To many people, when they talk about blasphemy, what crosses their mind is cursing. But blasphemy is not cursing. You see, when one utters words that are offensive in nature, when they are angry or frustrated, or they are annoyed, they are not blaspheming, they are cursing. So don't mix the two. So what is to blaspheme?
Kati okuvola cheki.
To blaspheme
okuvola
is to claim to be God.
Che kwekweita Katonda.
To blaspheme
okuvola
is to identify God
kwekukwata Katonda
with a lesser person or object. When you meet a creation and exalt it to the level of God, that is blasphemy. When you appropriate that which only God deserves, and and you appropriate it to a human being,
no chitwala no chigerageranya
no, or to a created thing,
obe chitu chonne chitondeddwa,
that is blasphemy.
Obo kuvola,
putting it point blank,
kanchirete mu bwangu,
idolatry
okusinze bibumbe
is a form of blasphemy.
Echo nacho kuvola.
If you fall down before men and stand tall before God, that is blasphemy.
Brother.
That is what it is. Not any different. So I want you to see what is happening. Because this is what is happening in the text that we see. This is the goal of the Antichrist. When we see the sea, him standing over the sea, sorry, on the shores of the sea, and we see the beast arising, there are a number of things I want you to observe. Now, for you to be able to understand what is happening here, we need to look at a number of scriptures to help us to gain perspective of what this all comes down to. We see the 10 horns. And for many people, you're asking, what does that symbolism represent? Why 10 horns? You see, horns are a symbol of strength. So what you see is powers that arise with the Antichrist or with the beast. Now, who is this beast? Many of us look at him as a person, and you're correct, but I want to add something. He is not just a person, he is also arising as a kingdom. So you have two in one. He is called the son of lawlessness. That is referring to a person. But he arises as a kingdom. And for you to understand that, you need to look at it from the aspect of what is presented to us in Daniel chapter 7. And you read this together with today's texts, Revelation chapter 13. And you add this to another scripture, which is Revelation chapter 17. So we will be going back and forth in these scriptures to paint for you a picture of who this beast is, how he gets this power, how he propagates his influence, and how he is able to get men and women of all walks of life upon the face of this earth to give him worship, the worship that can only, that is only to be ascribed to God Almighty. We will look at that in detail in the next session. Today I want us to understand about something. The flow of authority. You have the dragon standing on the sands, having rulership over kingdoms, having rulership over people. You see the beast coming out of the sea, which also represents powers that are being tossed to and fro. I believe that at this point in time, the Church of Jesus Christ has left, and now the Antichrist,
kati ng'omulabe wa Kristo,
this beast rises up to fill this void, empowered by the dragon, with the third party that we will see later, to form an unholy trinity that will lay hold of the minds, the hearts, and the lives of men, with the objective of leading them to hell. But within this text, we also learn that there are those whose names will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. It is only those that will escape this peril. The question I want to ask you who is listening, or you who is watching us, is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? You may ask me, how does that happen? That is the very simple way it happens. You have to believe Jesus with your heart and confess him with your mouth. Salvation will then come your way. Your name will then be written in the Lamb's Book. This book belongs to the Lamb. The Lamb owns it. So it is the Lamb that writes the names of those that he has washed. And you, in order to escape what is about to happen for all eternity, need to make sure that your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. If you are watching us or listening to us, your life has never been committed to Jesus, this is your moment to ensure that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Why don't you pray with us? Commit your life to Jesus. Let your name be written in the Book of Life. That is the only escape, my brother. That is the only escape, my sister. So if you are watching us today, or listening to us today, you have never given your life to Jesus Christ, you are not certain your name is in the Book of Life, why don't you say this prayer and mean it from the bottom of your heart? Ask the Lord to come into your life. For whatever acts you commit, they will not have your name written. No bribery, no influence whatsoever. There is no good act that you can do that will get God to have your name written. It is only accepting that which the Lamb died to purchase for you. So let's pray. Father,
Tata,
in the name of Jesus, I thank you for the gift of life, for the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ,
Yesu Christo,
who takes away the sins of the world. I am a sinner. I need a Savior. Save me, Lord. Save me, Jesus. Wash away my sins by your blood. Write my name in that Lamb's Book of Life. Today, I believe with my heart. Today, I confess Jesus as the one who died, was buried, and rose again on the last day. Today, I receive the life that God gives. Today, I receive the life that Jesus gives.
obulamu Yesu bwagaba.
Thank you Jesus.
Webale Yesu
for saving me.
Rokundokola.
Thank you Jesus.
Webale Yesu
for loving me.
Rokunjagala.
Amen.
Amen.
Now I am going to pray with you.
Ngenda kusabira.
But not only you. But I'm going to pray with that someone who is struggling with battles, who is struggling with so many vices in your life, who is so powerless, feels so powerless in this world, who is at the verge of giving up. Jesus has overcome.
Yes,
and in Christ Jesus, you yourself
now
can find victory. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you because you declare in your word, behold, I'm the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? You say in Luke chapter 1, verse 27, that with you all things are possible. We come to you, the God with whom nothing is impossible. Your people are challenged. Your people are helpless. But we stand in faith believing. Because you said if any two or three agree concerning anything in heaven or
earth,
it shall be granted to them. For those that are struggling with health issues, we understand and we know that by the stripes of Christ we are here. Therefore, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, we speak healing to every part of their body. We speak healing to every tumor. We speak healing to every fever. We come against every force of wickedness and darkness. You said in your word that the enemy may come against us like a flood. But the Spirit of the living God will raise up a standard. Precious Holy Spirit, arise now. May the enemies of the Lord be scattered. Arise now in the life of that brother. Arise now in the life of that sister, Lord. For somebody that is caught in the pitch of darkness, may you be the light that paves a way out of their situation. We speak a breakthrough for that one who is surrounded by barriers, for that one that is in chains of imprisonment, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. You said in your word, Lord, that we shall declare a thing and it shall be established for us. Therefore now we decree freedom. Now we speak healing. Now we speak life where there has been death. Now we declare freedom where there has been bondage. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, turn again the captivity of these your people. Place a song of rejoicing and gladness upon that one who has been weeping. Because you said in your word that weeping may endure for a night, but joy will come in the morning. Spirit of the living God, you are the great comforter, and the comforter has come. I pray you comfort the comfortless. Uphold that one whose head is bowed low. Restore that one that has lost everything. You promised to restore the years the cankerworm has taken. The years the hopping locust has taken. You promised to restore the years the crowing locust has taken.
osuubiza okuzzaawo byonna abantu obazze bujja
and we thank you
tukwebaza
because you follow your word to perform it
wagogoberera ekigambo
kyo thank you for the testimony
weebalolwa obujulizi
that is coming out of the mouth of it is your people
We
thank you for the word of testimony that is coming out of our way this week.
We
give you all the honor.
We
give you all the praise.
We
give you all the worship. In Jesus' name we pray. And God's people say it.
Amen.
Now, if God has done something, please, there is a line on the screen right now.
Our screen.
Call. Tell us what God is doing. Tell us how God is intervening in your life. Tell us about Jesus' faithfulness. We want to give glory to Him for what He's done in your life. And your life will never be the same again. So, until next time. From Dominion Church. We say shalom. And God richly bless you. Amen.
Amen.